Okay, first of all, let me say that I took a look, another look at the surprising result we got for the poll of 1,000 voters and 600 voted yes, voted for policy, and we got that I got that the probability you should be elected was almost unity, and apparently that's, I checked my calculations and I didn't find any mistake. I did the integrals from America. Well, Mathematica did the integrals from America. Anyway, so are there any questions before I start? I thought, let me just say a couple of words about what's called the Einstein nerds. Relation. The idea is that you have M dB dt for a colloidal particle, molecule, something or other in a fluid, minus velocity over some viscous effect. But you have an electric field, and the colloid has a charge Q, and then you have a random force F. What's different now is that the mean value of dV dt is minus V over tau. Let me say what tau is. Tau is in V. Minus V over tau plus QE over M. And this leads to a mean value. I'm going to skip the details and just give you the bottom line. The mean position then of R is Q tau squared E, tau being MB, B being the I guess the fluid, it's called the mobility. It's one over the friction. Yes, we have a hungry student. Hold on.
Well, on there, so its first physical meaning is tall, like a mean time between collisions.
It may be. That's, I don't know exactly, but that's something plausible because I just don't know, but it's presumably related. Certainly related, but what when the relation's unity, I just don't know. Is that something you looked up and asserted?
No, right? I'm not sure.
Okay, no. All right. So I certainly don't know.
No, I
But the meantime, I can tell you, the meantime between collisions is 10 to minus 21 seconds. So, and it depends on the density of the fluid, the temperature of the fluid, and everything.
And room temperature.
So it's probably not simply as simple as that, but it may be related. Anyway, this is Q tau squared E over M times T over tau minus 1 plus E to the minus T over 4. And this is assuming that everything starts quietly at the origin. And the upshot is that R minus R of T, minus, I should say, the mean value of R of T squared, the mean value of that turns out to be 6KT tau squared over M, and then again this T over tau minus 1 plus E to the minus T over tau. Okay, so that's that, and for large times this goes to as T over tau is much greater than 1, this goes to 6KT tau T over M And we set that equal to 6 dt by definition, where d is the diffusion constant. And then the Einstein-Nernst relation then is the d is the mobility times kt. It's also mu over, it's also kt tau over m. Well, b is tau, but m. And this is also written as mu kt over q, where mu is the charge times the mobility. Okay, so that's Einstein-Nernst. And it's used in biophysics, physical biochemistry, I guess, physical chemistry. Okay, fluctuation and dissipation. So this is again the Langevin approach, dvdt plus v over tau is this random acceleration. And what we do now is we multiply both sides by either t over tau. And then we recognize that that this, in fact, is ddt of v equal to t over tau. So let me get this. This is certainly equal to that, but I think that this is, yeah, I shouldn't have written this. So let's just do that. Wait a second, what am I? I am now a little bit puzzled by this. It's perfectly straightforward, and I'm just finding it a little bit puzzling here for the moment. So let's just write it again. dv dt plus v over tau is equal to the random acceleration and if we then multiply both sides by this exponential, what we get is v over tau e to the t over tau is a e to the t over tau. And, but this is not d by dt of v e to the t over tau. What is true is that this is d by dt of v e to the t over tau, because acting on that, we get this term. Acting on this, we get v over tau, that term. So this is, I guess it's all true now that I think about it, now that I've rewritten it. Okay, so that's right. Now we integrate. We integrate from 0 to t. And when we integrate from 0 to t, what we get, of course, is v of t e to the t over tau minus v of 0 is the integral from 0 to t a of t prime e to the t prime over tau dt prime. Okay, so that's the result of this integration. And now we multiply both sides by e to the minus t over tau, and we get v of 0 e to the minus t over tau plus e to the minus t over tau integral 0 to t a of t prime e to the t prime over tau d t prime. Now we square this. And when we square this, we get that the mean value of b squared of t is e to the minus 2t over tau mean value of b of 0 squared plus e to the minus 2t over tau, a double integral from 0 to t, of a of t1 dot a of t2 mean value e to the t1 plus t2 over tau dt1 dt2. And this thing here is called an autocorrelation function. That is to say, it's the mean value of the dot product, or the product, more generally, of two different things at two different times. Of the same thing at two different times. That's why it's autocorrelation. If it were two different things, it would just be a correlation function. So it's the mean value of that. And there are various properties that these have. I think I'm going to, I don't know, do you want to see a list of the properties of autocorrelation functions, or do you just want to read it? So, first of all, if the system is independent of time, if independent of time, then C of t, t plus s, which of course is a of t plus s, is independent of time and is just C, just depends upon the time difference. C, a second property is that C of TT, which is C of zero, is certainly non-negative because it's the dot product of, it's the mean value of the square of something. There's something else that's let's see, what's the simplest way of writing it? Well, there are many equivalent ways. Twice the absolute value of C of T1, T2 is less than or equal to C of T1, T1 plus C of T2, T2. And this for a time independent system, this is the statement C of S is less than or equal to C of zero. Absolute value of C of S, sorry, is less than or equal to C of zero. If we're talking about ordinary variables in classical physics, then C is symmetric. That is to say, C of T1, T2 is C of T2, T1. If, what did I call them? A of T1 and A of T2, if they commute, that is to say they're not differential operators or they're not quantum mechanical operators. If A of T is randomly fluctuating with a zero mean, then what's often true is that A of T1 dot A of T2 will be something like a constant C e to the minus T1 minus T2 over some characteristic time. So in other words, if the thing has a zero mean and it's fluctuating like crazy, then if the times are very close to each other, you get something that's non-zero, but otherwise it falls off. Not necessarily in a simple exponential, but one expects that it falls off. Okay, so I think I'm going to skip the rest of this. The next is Fokker-Planck, which I think is a little technical, so I'm going to skip that also and get to... Actually, I'm skipping an awful lot of stuff here. So the next topic is characteristic and moment-generating functions. Now, this is more important and much simpler. Okay? Sorry, I forgot to come, to go. Well, I mean, I was busy. I was talking with a graduate student until 7:30, and then eating dinner with my wife until 8:30, and then we watched an episode of Greek.
Were you able to find the episode that had the thing
in it? I haven't gotten around to it. I must do that.
You know what?
I'll put it on the website for the English class. Okay, characteristic. The characteristic function. And the characteristic function is essentially the Fourier transform of probability. So, I might write it this way. P tilde of k is an integral e to the I kx, p of x, dx. And consequently, you can invert and say that p of x is an integral e to the minus I kx, p tilde of k. And now you've got to have the 2 pi. So you know with the 2 pi's, you can either have 1 over 2 pi and no 2 pi here, or you can have just 1 here and 1 over 2 pi there, or you can have square root of 2 pi here and square root of 2 pi there. It's but you can't mix them. Okay, so if you adopt one convention, you have to stick with it. Stick with it for a given problem. In particular, Gaussian distribution, x, mu, sigma, is 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi, e to the minus x minus mu squared over 2 sigma squared. So this is a standard way of writing the Gaussian distribution. The Fourier transform is also a Gaussian. It's E, I'm going to skip a few steps, it's E to the I mu k minus a half sigma squared k squared. So it's a Gaussian in k, and I guess you could say it has an imaginary offset in a sense. If you have a discrete probability distribution, then this thing is the expected, here what we have, this is the expected value of e to the I kx. Here, if we're talking about a probability, it's then e to the I, the expected value of e to the I kn, and so it's a sum, e to the I kn, piece of n. I put an x in there in the original I don't know, in one version of the book, I think that's a mistake, choosers. The analog of X is simply M. Now,
so
yes.
What is the X then? This X of K?
Oh, that's because it's P of X.
Oh, okay.
So if it's P of X, then it's the mean value of EVIKX. If it's P of N, it's the mean value of EVIKN.
Okay.
And I guess I should start with the binomial. I left out the binomial when I wrote the book, so I decided to do it this afternoon. And if I haven't made a mistake, then the binomial distribution will be chi of n with the sum EVIKN, D then would be NN, PN 1 minus D to the N minus N. And what you notice is you can combine these two, and so this is a sum of NN P e to the ik to the n of 1 minus p to the n minus n. And this is p e to the ik plus 1 minus p raised to the power n. So that's, it turns out to be a rather simple formula. If we do the Poisson approximation to the binomial.
What are you summing over? Are you summing over M?
Summing over N. So the binomial distribution is, we sum from zero to big N.
That makes sense.
Well, the Poisson approximation to that, we have little, So that's the Poisson distribution. If we now do the Poisson, the characteristic function, so this is binomial, this is Poisson of K. Well, this would be a sum N e to the I K to the N over N factorial e to the minus n, and this is just e to the minus n, this is the sum of the exponential, and so this is e to the n, e to the ik. So that's an interesting compound exponential. Or equivalently, a better way of writing that is e to the n times e to the ik minus 1. All right. Now there's something very closely related to the characteristic function, and it's called the moment generating function. I put the put this chapter on the web page. I've made a few corrections and put it on the web page. So the moment generating function is M of K, and it's the mean value of e to the kx. And so it's the Fourier transform evaluated at minus I of K, or it's the characteristic function at minus I of K. And for a continuous distribution, this is an integral e to the kx, p of x, dx. And for a discrete one, m of k is just the sum e to the kn, pn. And in both cases, M of zero is one. It's the sum of all Pn's here, and over here is just the integral of P of x, so it's normalized. For Gauss and Poisson, M, well, what do? You just take here, replace k by minus ik, and then this is just e to the mu k, and then this, well, maybe I should write it down. Moment generating function, Gauss, k mu sigma, it's e to the mu k plus a half sigma squared k squared. And for the Poisson, it's e to the n e to the k minus 1. And I guess we could figure out what it is for the, where is the binomial? Well, here it would be just p e to the k. So pb would be p e to the k plus p minus p. All right, so now what you can do is you can expand these characteristic functions and moment generating functions about the value k equals zero. And what you get in general is that p is that the characteristic function p tilde of k is then a sum of, in other words, what it is here, let me first write what it is, and then, in other words, it's, so this is the continuous case, and so this is a sum, ik, to the n over n factorial, the expected value of x to the n. So these are the moments, and so this is ikn over n factorial, the mu-th moment, the nth moment. And the moment generating function, on the other hand, is simply k to the n over n factorial in the nth moment, because you replace k by minus ik. Okay, there's something called a cumulant. This is just a definition, so I'll write it over here. The nth cumulant is the nth derivative with respect to k of the log of m of k at k equals 0. And for an arbitrary probability distribution, these cumulants, you can actually compute the first five of them. C0 is 0, C1 is mu, C2 is sigma squared, C3 is the third central moment, and C4 is the fourth central moment minus 3 times the fourth power of the standard deviation.
Is C3 like kurtosis?
That's right. This one is called All right, let me get this right. The third and fourth normalized turbulence, I don't know what normalized means now that I think about it. I see. We divide by... All right, let me write it down. V is C3 over sigma cubed. That's what normalization means. And this is nu, the third central moment, divided by the cube of the standard deviation. That is called the skewness. And on the other hand, the kurtosis, kappa, is C4 over sigma to the fourth, or nu to the fourth over sigma to the fourth minus 3. And well, that's the kurtosis. So,
skewness is a measure of the asymmetry. Our fourth one there is a measure of the asymmetry.
The skewness, I think, measures the asymmetry, doesn't it?
Yeah.
All right, anyway. There are various distributions that, let's put it this way. We've been talking about the most famous distribution, which is the Gaussian. And these Gaussians go down very fast. They go down as essentially e to the minus x squared as we go out here in x. And so basically, all the probability is concentrated around the mean with a width sigma, basically. So in other words, this is mu, and this width is essentially sigma. Sigma. So the width there is sigma. And as we'll see before the end of the hour, almost everything occurring naturally and randomly is a Gaussian distribution, and it is concentrated in this way. On the other hand, other things, particularly things that involve people or finance or such things, can have what are called fat tails. So the distribution can look more like that, as opposed to one that goes down exponentially.
You could have an experimental error. You could have an experiment that has a fat tail error, couldn't you?
Yeah. I'm sure. In fact, one of the physical distributions, as an example, a over pi, a squared plus x squared, this is called a Bright-Wigner or a Cauchy distribution. And you see this thing goes down only as a polynomial 1 over x squared, whereas this is e to the minus x squared, and it's all the difference in the world between them. There's also Gossett's distribution, which is known as the student's T distribution, which is a generalization of this. I told you why it's called the student's distribution. Gossett worked for Guinness, the beer company in Ireland. And Guinness had a policy that wouldn't let its employees publish anything. And so Gossett sent his work into a journal and signed the paper student. And so it's been called ever since student's distribution. Okay, well, I list here many different distributions. I don't think there's any real point in dwelling on all of them. You can look at them and see what you think. Well, let me maybe mention a certain class of distributions. These are called Levy distributions. And These are rather funny distributions because they're characteristic functions. You can write a simple formula for the characteristic function of a Levy distribution, namely as e to the minus a nu absolute value of k raised to the power nu. What's curious is that the distribution itself, there's no simple formula for the distribution of itself in general. And they describe multi-scale phenomena. One of them, in fact, for the case of nu equal 2, the actual Levy distribution is the same as Bright-Bigner or Cauchy, and is something that does occur in various physical processes. But and for nu, I'm sorry, that's nu equal 1. Nu equal 2 is actually a Gaussian, so that's a very sensible one. But apart from nu equals 1 and nu equals 2, the Levy distributions are, there aren't any simple formulas for the distributions, whereas there are simple formulas for their characteristic functions. Okay, is there any question before I get to something really important?
You said the Levy scale, or the Levy formulas, distributions describe multi-scale, or what are some examples of distributions?
That's a great question. Okay, personal income, amplitudes of catastrophes, price changes of financial assets occur on small and large scales. In fact, there's something that's a rule of thumb for finance and is illustrated vividly in one of the best movies ever made called The Big Short.
Yeah,
you all seen that? Oh, you are. If you haven't seen it, do nothing else until you've seen The Big Short. It's one of the best films ever made, and there's a lot of accurate financial information in it. It's about the 08 crash and lead up to it. Well, that to stop going off on tangents, in finance, it's amazing. Two things are amazing and are characteristic of financial events. One is that they take an awfully long time to happen. And the other is that when they happen very fast. And so in the movie The Big Short, there was that very smart guy who was missing one eye and running a hedge fund or something. And he shorted the mortgage bonds. And it just took forever, even though it was apparent that the mortgage bonds were worthless and nearly or were way overpriced. They remained at their nominal prices, and then all of a sudden everything fell apart, and heads of the Federal Reserve banks were rushing, flying to Washington to meet with the Secretary of the Treasury, figuring out what the hell to do. So it's just a general rule of finance. So those are two scales. There's the scale at which the time scale that it takes for something to happen, and then the rate at which it happens when it finally does happen. Two enormously different scales. And it's typical of, it happens over and over again in finance, not just crashes, but many other things. Okay, now the really important thing is the central limit theorem. And so here's what we're imagining. We have capital N, and we imagine that this is big, capital N is big. Independent. Probability distributions. So P1 of X1, PN of XN. And not only are they independent, that is to say, the values of X1 and X2 are uncorrelated, but the probability distribution P1 could be Gaussian, P2 could be Poisson or some continuous version of Poisson, P3 could be a Levy, P4 could be... Yeah, I'm teaching now, okay. Oops. Yeah, I'm teaching now. Why? So, they can be n different independent probability distributions. And of course, we assume they're normalized and so forth. And we imagine they are finite beings, means mu j, and finite variances sigma j. Sigma j squared is the variance. The pj's can be all different. Now, here's the thing. If you take the average of all the x's, then the probability distribution for the average is a Gaussian as n goes to infinity. And now you might, let me just give you a vivid example of this, what I mean by n going to infinity. When I'm talking about infinity, I mean like 8. For example, suppose the probability distributions are just defined on the interval 0 to 1, and they're just uniform. So then, for n equal 1, the probability distribution looks like this. For n equal 2, it looks like this. For n equal 3, starting to look like a Gaussian. And for n equal 4, I can't tell it apart from a Gaussian. It just, I mean, you know, it's slightly different. But so it's just amazing how quickly that happens. And you see the uniform distribution is anything but a Gaussian. I think I did another example. Let me see. Yeah, all right, here's another example. All right, I'm gonna go over here because I see a little bit of black space. Here, the probability distribution is P of X is 3X squared. Okay. So for n equal 1, this is what it looks like. For n equals 1, it goes up to the value of 3. Duh. Okay, what happens for n equal 2? Well, for n equal... notice that this isn't symmetric at all. It's 3x squared. For n equals 2, it looks like this. For n equals 3, it's starting to look like that. And for n equals 4, is it 4 or 8? No, this is 8. For n equals 4, it's a damn good Gaussian, but of course the mean is off here. It's not at 1/2. So once again, I'm starting with something that's anything but a Gaussian, 3x squared, and just having 8 of them, adding them together, you get a bloody good Gaussian. Okay. So that means that if you're measuring something that depends upon eight or more particles or eight or more things that are interacting, and each of them has its own probability distribution, then the average is a Gaussian. So that's why the Gaussian distribution is so common in nature. And in fact, it's called the normal distribution. So let me now give you the derivation of this central limit theorem. And you might say, oh, this is going to be complicated. It's not complicated. It's very, very straightforward in terms of what we've already learned. It's much simpler than a lot of the stuff I skipped. Especially the part. Did anybody ask a question and not get candy?
Okay.
Oh, sorry. Anybody else?
Run today.
Huh? Anybody else? All right. Okay, let me get a squig of water here. All right, so here's the central limit theorem. So I've given you the basic ideas that we have. We have capital N independent things pj of xj with mean, finite variance. Y is 1 over n, x1 plus up to x capital N. And, okay, so, obviously the mean of y is going to be simply 1 over n, the sum of these means. So it's going to be mu1 plus mu2 plus mu capital N. So that's what the mean is for y. Since these are independent, the variance for y, the variance of y is 1 over n squared, and it's just the sum of the variances. You can verify that. It's basically because all these variables are independent. So any of the cross products cancel. All right. Now, inasmuch as the variables are independent, the joint probability distribution is just the product of P1 of X1, P2 of X2, Pn of Xn. And now, you guys all know about the delta function, I hope.
Proper?
Huh?
Which one?
Dirac's delta function.
Okay, yeah.
No?
Sure.
Yes or no? I mean, you want me to say something about it then?
Sure.
Okay. All right, well, technically, it's a distribution as opposed to a function, but everybody calls it a function in physics departments. On the other side of Lomas, they call it a distribution. And what is it? Well, basically it's this. It's something that maps a function f of x into the value of the function at a particular argument. So it's just a map. It turns out it's continuous. And there's a nuance. Again, this is true on the south side of Lomas. On the south side of Lomas, this thing is only meant to apply to functions that are super smooth. And there's a famous Russian mathematician, after the crash of the Soviet Union, moved to Rutgers and died about 10 years ago, wrote marvelous books and papers. In fact, he was distinguished by actually writing clearly, which I suppose meant that all the autistic mathematicians looked down on him. I can't remember his name, I'm terrible with name. Anyway, he invented a class of functions called test functions, and he said, all right, they're going to be infinitely differentiable, but zero outside some compact set. And so then the first thing he had to do was prove that these functions existed. And then he went on. Most people would say instead, well, they'll work this out for functions that are infinitely differentiable and go to zero faster than any power of x, as x goes to infinity. But basically, in physics departments, this is the only thing you really need to know. And the other thing is that that you can always integrate by parts. So in other words, f of x, delta prime of x minus x prime dx. Well, you integrate by parts, and so what you get is integral minus f prime of x, delta of x minus x prime dx. And you throw away the surface terms because obviously delta and delta prime are zero, and there, and so this is minus f prime of x prime. So that's basically what we need for the delta function. And now the probability distribution then for the variable y is an integral of p of x1, x2, x sub n. And now a delta function of x1 plus x2 plus xn over n minus y. And now we just integrate over all of the x's. Or, to write it more simply, dx1, dx2, dx capital N. So that's the probability distribution for y. It's normalized because if you integrate over y, this thing just gives you, the delta function just simply goes away and you have the integral of p over all the x's, which is 1. On the other hand, if we look at it here, it's a function, what's the probability of y? Well, it's the sum, the integral over all the probable possible values of x, such that the sum of the x's over n is equal to y. So then what, so that's what p of y is. What is the characteristic function of p of y? And now I'm going to have to call, I didn't want to use this notation, but I guess I have to distinguish p of y from p of all the x. Maybe I don't. I don't know if I need the n, actually. In any event, this is going to be an integral, e to the I k y, p All right, if I put in the N. So that's what the characteristic function is for the probability distribution of the average value Y. And so using this formula for P of Y, what we have is e to the I k y integral p of x1 xn, so I'm just doing this formula, delta of x1 xn over big N minus y. Let me just call that dn of x dy. Okay? Now, this is actually very simple. Because the rule of a delta function, the rule of a delta function is that you replace the function by its value. Namely, that value. So y, when you integrate over y, f of y gets replaced by the value x1, the sum of all the x's over n. And so this becomes integral e to the ik over big N, x1 plus x capital N. And what's left is all of this, p of x1, x capital N, and then integrating over all the x's. On the other hand, we know that this p is just a product of the independent probability distribution. And so this is actually e to the ik over big N x1 plus x capital N p1 of x1 p2 of x2 pn of xn. And that means that the characteristic function for what, for the probability distribution of y, is just the product of the characteristic functions. And evaluated the same argument, k over n. Hard to write at the bottom of the whiteboard. So the characteristic function for the distribution of the average y is the product of the characteristic functions. Okay. We're almost done now. Now each characteristic function, remember over there we I'll give you another candle.
Okay.
You remember that the characteristic function can be expanded in terms of as ik to the n over n factorial times the nth moment. So we're going to use that over here. If I get a came out of candy. Oh, good catch. Why did you want a candy? Anybody else want a candy?
Yeah.
Okay, So let's... All right, so what we have then...
football.
Is that this thing is the product of the characteristic functions, and each of the characteristic functions we're evaluating it not at k, but at k over big N. And we're letting big N go to infinity, where infinity is 4 or 8. All right. And so this is 1 plus ik over N mu j minus k squared over 2 N squared mu 2j, in other words, the second moment of the jth distribution. But it turns out that the second moment is always sigma squared plus mu squared for any j. That's just the standard thing, namely, the integral of x squared dx is equal to the integral of x squared minus mu squared plus mu squared p dx. I mean, obviously you can do that. And then the integral of mu squared p of x is just mu squared. The integral of this is sigma squared. All right, so I'm really out of space, so let me flip this over and so I'm making something of a big deal of this central limit theorem because I think it's really, really important. Have you seen it in other courses? Oh, you have? Oh, I'm boring you.
I haven't seen the theory behind it.
Yeah.
Just plus an explanation.
Oh, you didn't get the derivation?
Yeah, just stated that it was a thing.
Yeah, all right. Well, let me give you the rest of the derivation then. So basically, what we can say then is that t tilde j at k over n is 1 plus ik over n mean of xj minus k squared over 2n squared. And previously I had mu2j, and I'm writing it now as sigma j squared plus uj squared. And this for large n is essentially the same thing as e to the ik uj over n minus k squared over 2n squared times sigma j squared. This is all in the exponent. So in other words, when you expand this exponential for big N, you get 1, and then you get ik n over n mu j, and then you get minus k squared over 2n squared sigma j squared. But then the next term that's quadratic brings this in with a minus sign, a 1/2, k squared over n squared mu j squared. That's where this one comes from. Okay. And then you drop higher terms, because we're on the north side of ones. Okay. So what do we have? What we have is that the characteristic function for the average value of the sum of the n random variables, n independent random variables given by different probability distributions, is just a product Well, I wrote it as a product. I don't know why I wrote it as a product. Anyway, it's Pj of k over n. And that's the product over j, approximately, of e of this thing, e to the I k mu j over n minus k squared over 2n squared sigma j squared. And so if we rewrite that, that product is really e to the I k over n sum of mu j's minus k squared over 2n squared sum of sigma j squared. But this is the characteristic function of Gaussian. Remember, Cayman, can I'll give you a candy. Turn it.
Oh.
This is the characteristic function of the Gaussian. It's e to the I mean times k minus a half sigma squared k squared. Okay. So now.
My love can be won.
So what this tells us is that this is e to the I mu of y, the mean of y times k, minus a half sigma y squared k squared. That's because 1 over capital N squared sum of the sigma j squared is what we found on the other side of the board was sigma y squared. And 1 over n, the average value of the means is what we found to be the mean of the average. Well, it's an equal sign. And that means then that Pn of y is just the inverse Fourier transform of P tilde n of k dk over 2 pi. And this is then the this is 1 over sigma y square root of 2 pi e to the minus y minus mu y squared over 2 sigma y squared. So, in other words, as n goes to infinity, which for practical purposes is 4, 8, 16, something like that, the probability distribution of the average goes to a Gaussian. Normalized, well, it has to be normalized, but it goes to a Gaussian. And in the class notes, which are on the class webpage, you can see some actual illustrations of this, which I worked out with Fortran and MATLAB and Mathematica or whatever. There are some people, in particular Lindberg and Feller and Nedenko, worked out some of the rigorous aspect of this, but since we're on the north side, we don't have to worry about that. So let's see, this, something about random number generators. We only have a couple of minutes left, so I'll just tell you these very simple things. First of all, what we use are pseudo-random generators. That is to say, we have some mathematical algorithm that pumps out specific random numbers according to a formula. So they're not random, but they're good enough. Now, there was a funny story, by the way, where, all right, in fact, let me in fact tell you something that What do you have to, the important thing, the most important thing, if you're using random numbers, is that you have to make sure that you, if you're going to do a calculation with random numbers, and you're going to do the same calculation several times and then average the result to get a better value, you want to make sure that you choose, that you start at a random point in the random number generator sequence. Because the thing, what the random number generator does is it generates a sequence of random numbers, x1, x2, dot, 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 x39, dot, 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 and so forth. And these often have very long sequences. The GNU Fortran 95 compiler used a random number generator that had a period longer than 2 to the 59. Some Japanese mathematicians invented something called the Mersenne twister that has a period that is 2 to the 1997 minus 1, that's the length of the period. And so it just keeps going. However, you can screw up if you do several calculations starting with the same x1, you're going to get the same answer for each of the calculations. And one group doing, this was about 30 years ago, a group doing what were then really large-scale calculations, they've got to reset the seed, or screwed up on the resetting or something, and they wasted 90% of their work and had to redo it. So how do you reset the seed? Let me just mention, I'll mention how you do it in GNU Fortran in C. It's something else. Maybe one of you knows what it is in C. In the GNU Fortran 95 compiler, you write call init underscore random underscore seed. And that calls a subroutine that I define that later in the next chapter. And then when you want to get a random number, you just say call random underscore number of x, and that returns a number x that's uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. That's the default. Oh goodness, we're out of time. So, what? Oh, I thought somebody said something. All right. Okay, so let's, Cayman, if you turn it off, I'll give you another candy.